Back in the 1980s and early 90s, whenever I went to set up a game on my PC, I always had to pick what sort of video card I was going to be using, but then also what kind of sound card. Now, I was very familiar with the ad-lib and Sound Blaster cards. Everybody knew about them, even if they didn't have one. And of course, everyone had the option of the internal PC speaker. But most games also had an option for the Roland MT-32. So to me, the MT32 was always some kind of mysterious, expensive sound card that only really rich people could afford. Well, it turns out that while it was a bit on the expensive side, it wasn't a sound card at all, at least not entirely. You see, the MT32 was an external MIDI module. Now, let me explain to you what the original purpose of it was. So, the way these were designed to work is that you would have your MIDI-compatible keyboard, then connect it to the MIDI module. Now, the module will listen to the keys that you press and actually synthesize the sounds and send them out to your amplified speakers. Now, the reason you might do this is because some MIDI keyboards are really nothing more than controllers, and they actually don't produce any sounds at all. They just send the information to some other device telling it what keys you've pushed on the keyboard. Of course, some people simply had cheap keyboards that had either very few sounds or the sounds they had weren't very good, and they wanted to take advantage of an external module so that they could have more sounds or more realistic sounds or both. Also, it was possible to connect up a MIDI sequencer in between, which would allow you to record the notes that you were playing in digital form. However, it was also possible to connect these modules up to a PC and then play the music from there. Or, the PC could even be a MIDI sequencer, allowing the creation of music right there. Well, the Roland MT32 found success outside of the music market by simply being used by consumers as a way to listen to the music in their games. Here's a list of games on the IBM PC that supported the MT32. It's actually quite a long list. Quite a very long list indeed. Also, the MT32 could be connected to other computers, such as the Atari ST, which already has MIDI connectors built in from the factory. Unfortunately, far less software was available on this platform, with only about a dozen games supporting it.
So you might ask how this module would have connected to a PC, considering that back then, and even today, most PCs do not have MIDI ports on them.
Well, this was usually accomplished by installing a Roland MPU-401 compatible MIDI card into one of the expansion sockets of the PC, like this one. The MT32 uses something called LA synthesis, and no, that doesn't stand for Los Angeles, it actually stands for linear arithmetic. Now, it has 128 built-in sounds, 32 voice polyphony, and it responds to 9 MIDI channels. So let's talk about the LA synthesis for a moment. It's really a hybrid between PCM samples and subtractive synthesis. So if you look at a waveform produced by the MT32, the attack portion of the sound is actually a digitized PCM sample, but then the sustain and release part of the sound is actually handled by a more old school synthesis. So most of the sounds on the MT32 are pretty realistic.
In order to demonstrate the vast difference between the MT32 and other sound cards, I'm going to show you one of my favorite games from 1989, which is Sierra's Space Quest III.
I'm going to let you hear the difference between how the game sounded on the PC speaker, basically people who didn't have any sound card at all, and then I'll show the Tandy 3-voice sound chip, followed by the ad-lib Sound Blaster version, and then finally the MT32 for comparison. Notice that the MT32 shows a little joke on the screen when the game starts. Thank you. Okay, that was the intro. What about the in-game music? The PC speaker version has no music, so we'll go straight to the Tandy sound. So, of course, we have to take it apart because, well, that's just what we do here. You can see this thing is packed with the best technology of the 1980s. Most interesting is that it contains an Intel 8095 CPU. To the best of my knowledge, these four chips are ROM chips, which probably contain sample data and program code, etc. This appears to be 64K of dynamic RAM. However, oddly enough, it appears to have another 32K of static RAM, and with all this stuff, it's no surprise it was an expensive piece of hardware back then.
So, how can you connect this thing to a modern computer? Well, you know, that's kind of one of the interesting things about the MT32. Of all of the vintage sound devices used in DOS games, this is the only one that can still be used on a modern computer without being, you know, emulated. Because it does have standard MIDI ports, you can just plug it into any MIDI device.
I just bought a Roland USB to MIDI adapter, plugged that into my Mac Mini, and then plugged the two MIDI cables into the Roland MT32, and then I used my 80s boombox for sound output. Now, I can play music directly from modern MIDI applications, but what's more interesting, at least to me, was that I could actually use it with DOS games running inside of DOSBox. All I had to do was edit the DOSBox config file and change the output from Core Audio to Core MIDI, and the games will send the MIDI information right out to the MT32. So what about using it as a MIDI synthesizer for a keyboard? Well, any MIDI keyboard will work, even modern ones. I'll take my little Casio here and connect up the MIDI cable to it. Unfortunately, at first, it did not work. You see, the MT32 has 5 parts, which are individual channels of music, each corresponding to the 5 buttons on the front, which allow you to modify each of the channels. It also shows these little 5 parts on the screen and blinks them when the music is playing, so you know which parts are being used. It also has another 3 parts that you can't really edit or see on the screen, but it'll still play them. And then there's one more part, which is the rhythm or drums channel. Now, standard MIDI is designed to work with up to 16 channels. But for some reason, by default, the MT32 assigns its parts to MIDI channels 2 through 10. Now, my Casio keyboard will only transmit on channel 1, so essentially nothing will ever happen. However, if you hold down the master volume and press 5, it will ask if you want to remap the channels to 1 through 8. So press 1 to accept the change. Now the mapping will look like this, and now it is possible to play with my Casio.
So I mentioned that it had 128 sounds, but they're arranged a little strange in sound groups.
So you can press the sound group button, and it'll scroll through a list of groups, and then you can press the sound button and scroll through a list of sounds. So let me show you a more graphical representation of what you're actually doing, since the little one-line screen can be confusing. So when you're scrolling through groups, it looks like this. And then when you're selecting a sound, it is a sound within that group. So when you look at the screen, you'll always see the group on the left and the actual sound on the right.
So I'm going to give you a little sampling of some of the sounds. I'm not going to play all 128 of them because that would take forever. But I will show you the piano, and let me tell you that the piano, ironically enough, is one of the least convincing instruments on the MT32. In fact, the piano was always one of the most difficult instruments to recreate on vintage sound hardware before everything moved to PCM samples entirely. So just about everything else on the MT32 actually sounds pretty darn good, even by today's standards. In fact, I bet you didn't notice, but my intro song at the very beginning of the video was actually done on the MT32. If you didn't notice, go back and watch it again. And also, all of the incidental or background music that I've been using in this video up to this point has also been made on the MT32 as well. I'd also like to give out a big thanks to Anders Jensen, who sent this to me and donated it. He sent this all the way from Norway. And he's also the one that's done a lot of the music in many of my more recent episodes, including this one.
If you want to know where I got that cool Roland t-shirt, it was from a Synth Meetup in Grand Prairie, Texas that I attended last weekend. This took place in a furniture store and there was lots of neat gear there.
Now, if you want to stick around, I'm going to show you just a few more screenshots from some old DOS games using the MT32, which I think you'll find impressive. Alright guys, I hope you enjoyed learning about the Roland MT32. I think this is a fantastic piece of both computer history and music history. Now, the MT32 was eventually replaced by some other products. For example, the Roland MT100, which is kind of an MT32 mixed with a sequencer all in the same unit. It was also eventually replaced by units like the CM series. Now, this poor guy here is in some serious need of some Retrobrite, and that's actually something I plan on doing in an upcoming episode, so this should look a lot better. Speaking of Retrobrite, I traded a Nintendo Entertainment System for this Atari ST here, believe it or not, and it actually works, and I want to show off more of its MIDI capabilities in an upcoming episode. But it needs some Retrobrite pretty bad, and I'm going to be doing that. But that'll probably be on my 8-Bit Guy channel. But most of you guys subscribe to that too, and if you don't, you need to.